Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. Good evening.
Good evening.
One of those. I'm Ryan Kabuju from the School of Public Administration at the University of Central Florida. I welcome you to the 4th Annual Distinguished Lecture Series. And the College of Health and Public Affairs focuses on programs in public affairs and health-related programs, and a lot of interdisciplinary programs, including PhD in public affairs, social work, public administration, criminal justice. And those programs are critical for the mission of the College of Health and Public Affairs in terms of strengthening communities and changing lives. And the mission of the lecture series as well focused on healthy communities. They focus on planning and transportation. And the lecture series do bring planners, a lot of students from our planning program, and also practitioners in the Central Florida community together regular basis, twice, three times in a year. And the sponsors of this lecture series, VHP and Metropolitan Orlando, we thank them. Without their support, this is probably not possible to have that many people with food. And thank you. And also the Orlando Metro section of American Planning Association Florida chapter sponsors credits for planning degree programs as well. So this is their support, in-kind contribution to the Distinguished Lecture Series. With that, I look forward for the presentation and the comments from the panelists. And I will give the mic to Dr. Chris Hawkins. He's the Planning Program Director at the School of Public Administration at UCF. Chris?
Good evening. I'll be very brief. Before we get started, I want to recognize some individuals that make the planning program a success. We have a very active and strong and engaged advisory board. These are volunteers that meet quarterly and help improve the curriculum and community engagement. So if you're on the advisory board for the planning program, if you could please stand and be recognized. I'll also add too is, although the planning program is relatively new, we started in 2010, I'm glad to announce that we have alumni in Tennessee, Texas, Utah, and of course Central Florida in both the public and private sectors. of course, the program wouldn't be successful without core faculty. Jay Dury, Dr. Marianne Feldheim, Dr. Capuccio, and Roberta Fennessy, who's an instructor. So a round of applause. And of course, one of the primary reasons why we're here is to help our students and chart a path for a successful career. If you're a student in the program now, or an alumni, you could stand and be recognized. So, thank you for attending. This series has been exceptional and very engaging, so I expect nothing but the best from tonight. I'm sure it will be very, very exciting. Thank you again. And I'll turn it over to Mr. Sellen.
I think you can all hear me, and Chris was brief. I intend to be brief.
Thank you all for giving up the Benghazi hearings. Some of you probably riveted to that at the demonstration or whatever. When we started the speaker series, I remember meeting with Marianne and Michael Frumpkin and Harry and myself and several others, Owen Veitch. And our goal was to try and create an opportunity to get the students to be able to mix with business people in the community. Because obviously we've got great students with great capability. A lot of them, most of them probably already have jobs, but we want to make sure that they get exposed to some of the key people in the area, and that by virtue of doing that, there's opportunities to have work study and some other opportunities in terms of, you know, what you do in major papers, and I don't know all the right terms, but you understand what I'm saying. And I think that started to work. This is our third year, and we're going to keep doing this, and hopefully we'll get a little more organized. I think the only reason we don't have more people here is that we aren't as organized as we probably should be, but I will also say some of our best programs have been programs where we've had the opportunity to interact on a smaller scale, so I'm really looking forward to tonight. My other job is to introduce Harry Barley, who really doesn't need any introduction. 30 years in the profession here in Orlando has made such a huge difference in how we do transportation planning. I came here, in 1974 as a planner in Orange County. And, you know, I've watched our transportation agencies. We have never, ever had the type of capability our transportation agency has under Harry, and the real big picture Harry that you take is very, very much appreciated. His resume says that, you know, he worked in China or worked on projects in China and Greece and all that, and you know, we're just glad you're here. So anyway, let me introduce Harry Barley.
Thank you, Jim, and good evening, everyone. In my role as a member of the advisory board and Inspector Plan Orlando is one of the sponsors, I was asked to serve as the moderator for tonight's program. And when asked to do something like that, what's the right answer?
Yes. Of course, sure.
So as a moderator tonight, my job is to introduce a few of my friends, and I have the pleasure of knowing most of these people. I get to introduce a few of my friends. Who are really going to take the lead with tonight's program, which I hope will be informative and provocative. My job is to keep things moving, and my job is also to bring this in for a landing on time. Dr. Feldheim and Roberta, we're not going to use that clock, okay? We're going to use a different one to cover a lot of ground tonight by 8 o'clock. But first, I need to ask the group, am I the only one that had a tough time registering for the program tonight?
No.
Okay, I'm glad. Who had a tough time registering? Okay, a lot of hands going up. That's something we also need to fix. Okay, everybody's signaling me. I do need to use the mic. That is something we do need to fix as we move ahead and continue with this. But yeah, I had a really tough time. This is a free lecture, and I felt like I was transferring money to the Cayman Islands or something with all this going on. And I was not successful with either money transfer or registering. When I checked in tonight, despite my good efforts with all of my email addresses and all of my secret codes, I never did get registered. But for those of you who couldn't register, I'm still glad you came. So we're going to work to get that fixed. It's my pleasure tonight to introduce our distinguished speaker tonight to get things going, Mr. Dale Allen. Dale's the president of the Florida Greenways and Trails Foundation. Before assuming his current position, Dale served for almost 30 years with the Trust for Public Land, a prominent national land conservation organization. During this time, he played a leading role in many large-scale conservation projects right here in Florida, and by the way, he is a Florida native. And one of these was being a champion for the program that has become known as the Florida Greenways and Trails Program. Hundreds of miles of abandoned railroad right-of-way have been purchased through this program, and because of Dale's good work, these facilities are now enjoyed by hundreds of thousands of visitors, both domestic and international, each year. Now, Dale retired in 2009, and while he has succeeded in everything in life, up to that point, he failed at retirement.
that did not work out too well. This is someone who just has way too much energy and way too much enthusiasm to do something traditional retirement. So that's when he took his role with the Florida Greenways and Trails Foundation, and we have all benefited from his visionary work. The Florida Greenways and Trails Foundation is Florida's leading advocacy organization for a statewide system of off-road and shared-use paved and hardened surface trails. I wanted to get that right. I'm still working with some of the vocabulary on the different types of trails. Many of you may have to learn about that as well. But connected off-road and shared-use paved and hardened surface trails, as opposed to soft surface trails, which you're supposed to be on. Dale spearheaded the campaign to close the gaps among the existing trail segments we have in the state, and that campaign was actually a catalyst for what we now call the Coast to Coast Trail. And that's an exciting project. It's going to have a huge impact here, right in Central Florida. And you're going to learn a lot more about that tonight in the course of Dale's remarks. Now, in addition to having Dale with us tonight, we are very, very grateful he worked this into his schedule and he made the trip. Something even better than having Dale, we have his wife, Karen, with us also. And many of Dale's adventures around the country, around the world, Karen has been in his company experiencing all that. So we actually have two experts in the room with us tonight. And if you haven't had a chance to meet both of them, I hope you'll get a chance to do that before the program is over this evening. So please join me in giving a very warm welcome to Dale Allen.
I'd like to dim the lights, if you don't mind, if anybody objects to it, we'll leave some of the doors open. But I think you'll see the images I'm going to share with you tonight better. Is this too dark for anybody? Okay. Is that going to work for everybody? Okay. Well, Harry Barley, thank you very much for introducing my wife and me. We're very grateful to be here tonight with you all. And I would like to add my word of thanks to the sponsors, VHB and Metro Plan Orlando. It's an honor to be able to speak before this distinguished group of people. And I'd like to take you on a journey with me tonight and share with you some of the remarkable things that have been happening now kind of quietly and under the radar for the last 30 years all across the United States and the country, and share with you some of the kind of underlying public policy that is driving all this, because I think it's fundamentally very sound. And we tend to, in our hurry, our rush to get these things done, we tend to forget why we're doing a lot of this. So I'm going to share some of that with you tonight. Is that better? Okay, all right. I looked so good. You couldn't see from the camera up there, okay. So tonight's my topic is Florida Greenways and Trails, a proven paradigm for community development, personal mobility, and public health. But the real topic is, what's all this trail buzz I've been hearing and reading about lately? If you've been reading the Orlando Sentinel for the last year, it seems like there's an article every week about the Coast to Coast Trail and the general high level of excitement that is accompanying this project. Why is that? So tonight, in helping you better understand what the buzz is all about, I'm going to do the following. I'm going to introduce five themes for your pleasure tonight. One, I'm going to try to explain to you quickly what a greenway and trail, how they're different. I'm going to help you understand more what's happening around North America with regard to these trails and why this is happening. I'm going to help you understand some of the forces behind what's driving these trails forward right now, and then what's going on specifically in Florida. I'll share with you some maps showing you where the trails are actually being developed and are proposed, and then how this will affect you. And last, I'm going to take you all on a little bit of a world tour of trails to kind of show you that this is much bigger than just Florida or the United States. Okay, let's get started. Okay, a greenway. A lot of confusion about what's the difference between a greenway and a trail, and in my mind, it's real simple. The greenway is the land corridor that allows for a safe non-motorized passage of wildlife and people, the land corridor itself, okay? Whereas the trail is the actual footpath or paved surface through the greenway. And I've given you three examples here. This is I-75, and this is the land bridge over I-75. How many people have seen that land bridge? How many people knew what it was? Okay, that, more hands went up. That's interesting. They knew what it was and they haven't seen it. Okay. A little quicker on these. Okay. Anyway, this is part of the Cross Florida Greenway, a very unique artifact that used to be called the Cross Florida Barge Canal. and I-75 severed it, and to be able to get people safely across the interstate, Department of Transportation built this remarkable structure. The Greenway is all the land on both sides of it, the trail is that, right across there. This is a trail along the Greenway in North Carolina. This is the Neuse River Trail. That's the trail. All the land along that is the Greenway. But here's another example. This is the Rose Kennedy Greenway in downtown Boston. If you were in Boston 20 years ago, that would have been I-95 blasting through the town, okay? I-95 is now under the Greenway. That's what the big dig was all about, okay? And on top of it, what a trade. On top of it, they don't only have a multi-lane highway under this, they have this absolutely beautiful linear park that goes for about a mile and a half through downtown Boston. That's the Greenway, that's the trail. Okay? We're very fortunate, Clark. We have not only a state master plan, which is this document right here, it's available online, and I would ask you to go look at it. It kind of outlines what Florida is intending to do, but we have a series of different trails. We have blue ways. This is an example of a blue way. And you see that blue line that goes all around Florida? That's not just the outline of Florida. That's the Florida Circumnavigation Paddling Trail. Another question, how many people knew there was such a thing as a Florida Circumnavigation Paddling Trail? All right, fewer hands. This is all marked. You can literally get in a kayak, start at Fernandina Beach, and there's designated campsites. You can go all the way around the state of Florida and end up on the Gulf Islands National Seashore. It's about a 45-day journey. And about 30 to 40 people a year are now making this trip. Okay, all the way around Florida. All the rivers in Florida are part of that Blue Way network. That's the Peace River, that's the St. John's River. The orange is the Florida National Scenic Trail, and this is an example of what that hiking experience. But we also have scenic highways, and this is the only all-American scenic highway in the state of Florida. It's in the Florida Keys. But all these trails work together. They all work together to do something we call slow transit. Slow people down and let them better appreciate the unique landscapes that Florida has. We don't have mountains. We don't have these vast vistas that just transform you with one glance. To see Florida, you've got to see it at a more human pace, and this is the way to do it. So we're very fortunate to have all this. We're also very fortunate because Florida is now at the threshold of something quite remarkable. And this is the project that Harry referred to that started all this going. And I'll explain more about how it got going later. But let me just share with you the highlights right now. When the foundation got started on this project, we realized that there were 14 trails in Central Florida, all of them in existence, that if you added them all up, they added up to 200 miles. And that with a little bit of luck, closing seven gaps, we could connect these trails all the way across the state of Florida. So we had 75% of the trail already there. Nobody saw it as a continuous trail. So this is transportation. That was already in place. We also have, thanks to the Florida legislature, the Florida DOT now has money through their work plan to complete this project. And they're still talking about completing the whole project by 2020. So within a very short period of time, a little bit more, 5 or 6 years, this trail will be substantially finished. And it's going to take Florida from being in the lower quartile of states with trails to having the longest trail in the southeast and one of the longest of the 10 trails in the nation. So this is all happening thanks to the legislature and DOT. In addition, and I'll come back to the 600 numbers, so pay attention to it, we have 600 miles of a 2,000-mile state network that is also not only in the planning works, but is about to be developed. And I want to share that with you tonight because this is just starting now, starting this summer. This started when the 2015 legislature created the Sun Trails program. And Sun is an acronym for Shared Use Non-Motorized. So the Sun Trails program was created in the Department of Transportation, and it gives them $25 million a year now of recurring revenue to complete this trail. This revenue comes from vehicle registration fees from out-of-state cars coming to Florida. And the theory the legislature used to allocate this money was Florida's roads are already at capacity in many cases. If you're bringing more cars in, you're adding to the overcapacity problem of our roads. You pay a whopping registration fee when you register a car in Florida from out of state. Part of those fees will now be going to build the Sun Trail system. So there's some real equity in this decision that the legislature created. And the real reason I'm so interested in this is because of this one. These trails are going to have an astonishing impact on rural and mid-sized communities all over Florida as they begin to come online, and I'll share you some examples of it later. If you haven't been to Winter Garden, you must go to Winter Garden. 20 years ago, before the trail was in there, that community was a collapsing citrus packing town. 30% of the buildings were occupied in the downtown core, and it was not a place people wanted to move to. It's now become one of the most attractive communities in Central Florida. Winter Garden. Same is true with Dunedin on the Pinellas Trail. Both of these beautiful downtowns are 100% occupancy in their urban core. And imagine what's going to happen when we connect those pieces of trail together into a statewide network, and people will be able to travel from the Atlantic Ocean through these places to downtown St. Petersburg. Imagine that when the whole state is connected. And last, we have been buying in the state of Florida over the last 30 years well over 1 million acres of conservation lands. We now have probably the largest public land estate, certainly of any state in the Southeast, and we're rapidly approaching some of the Western states, the amount of public land we have now in public ownership. Imagine if we could only connect a third of these public lands to these trail systems. We would have a tourist attraction that would be remarkable in the world. So I'm going to show you more about this as the night goes on. You know, what are these trails? Okay, this is one of my absolute favorites.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! I've got to convert back here. Steve just came back this summer from riding the Great Allegheny Passage. This trail was completed about 5 years ago, and it now connects Point Park in downtown Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, all off-road, all the way to Washington, D.C., 400 miles. And it came about because of two things: a series of abandoned railroad corridors, and when it gets into Maryland, this was the historic canal that was built in the 1820s and 1830s called the Chesapeake and Ohio Canal. Before trains, the way we were trying to move freight in bulk across the country was through the canal system. Everyone's heard of the Erie Canal. There were many canals built like that along the east coast of the United States. Most of them have been lost. This one was safe, and you can ride a trail along this canal 165 miles from downtown Washington, D.C., all the way to Cumberland, Maryland, and then through a series of trails crossing to Pennsylvania and ride the Great Allegheny Passage all the way to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Pretty remarkable. This is also, our Canadian brothers have done this. This is the Confederation Trail. It's on Prince Edward Island. Now, many people don't know where Prince Edward Island is, but it's the smallest province in Canada, and it's in the Gulf of St. Lawrence. And if you've ever gone swimming in the Gulf of St. Lawrence, it's a terrifying experience because the water temperatures get into the low 60s in the heat of August. So it's frigid waters. And before this trail, they only had 2 months of tourism, July and August, because it took those 90 degree days before anybody could even think of getting into the water. When this trail was completed about 5 years ago, connecting one end of Prince Edward Island to the other, a whole new month of tourism was created on this island. September is now bike month. Steve, you gotta go. Okay, Prince Edward Island, absolutely beautiful. And at this, when you're talking, Gary, this is what we mean a hardened circle. I'm sorry, let me go back one. This is what I mean by a hardened surface here. This is not paved. This is a kind of a crushed stone matrix. And as long as it's not sand or mud, you can ride pretty well on these trails, okay? And when you've got extreme temperature conditions like Canada does, pavement doesn't last as long as these crushed stone trails actually do last. Okay? In the high urban areas, you'll get more of a traditional paved bike trail. Okay, anyone from Missouri here? Okay, Missouri's got one of these. This trail has become a tourist attraction in Missouri. Imagine that. This is the Cape, the Kansas, Arkansas, and Tennessee, Texas Railroad. 250 miles of an abandoned railroad corridor linking St. Louis, suburbs of St. Louis, all the way across almost to Kansas City. It has a remarkable feature in that there used to be two separate train systems, one on the north bank of the Missouri River and one on the south. The one on the north bank failed and was purchased by the state of Missouri and converted the trail. So you can literally ride your bike from St. Louis to Kansas City, get on a train, and come all the way back to St. Louis. How about that for a loop? Okay, pretty cool. The Silver Comet. This is currently the longest trail in the Southeast. It is now, this is in Georgia. It connects from outside of Atlanta at Smyrna near Marietta to the Georgia-Alabama line, and then it joins a 64-mile trail in the Alabama line called the Chief Ladega Trail all the way to Anniston. So this trail now is not 94s, it's 150 miles, and they've got the bragging rights. And they're doing t-shirts here that basically say longest trail in the southeast. So we're going to snatch that away from them in about 4 years, and we'll have 100 more miles than they do. But what a beautiful thing this is. It's a concrete trail, 12 to 15 feet wide, going through tunnels, across bridges, way out into the countryside. This trail will receive as many as 15 to 20,000 people on a weekend in the spring. So, okay, SilverCon. Now, Flora, and this is our personal favorite, Coeur d'Alene. Coeur d'Alene is in the panhandle of Idaho, the skinny stovepipe that goes up to the Canada border. This trail is kind of remarkable for lots of reasons. First of all, it was a Superfund trail project. When the train was operating, it was operating in these valleys right here. And this was called the Silver Valley because of all the wealth that came out of from the material ores, the golds and silvers that were taken out. And they took all the tailings from that mining operation and they used it to extend the railroads. Well, those ore mines were full of heavy metals. And when the railroad closed operations, EPA came in and said, okay, guys, you gotta get rid of this stuff. So you have a choice. You can either haul it all the way to a hazardous waste site and bury it, or you can seal it under asphalt and create a trail. What do you think they chose to do? This was the $50 million option versus the $500 million option. Okay? And in the process of burying that, sealing that hazardous material under all these trails, they created an immense tourist attraction. The little town of Wallace in the Panhandle now gets 250,000 visitors a year. This is 600 people a year. 250,000 people. They also have some interesting features. Look how they did this bridge. That was the old railroad alignment right there. Because they weren't going to open and close this for bicyclists, they lifted it up, fixed it in place, and built the trail up and down to the other side. You can see it coming across here. And anyone know what that is? It's not an alligator. Not an alligator. He's about to go the other way. They are 4.5 foot fence along both sides of this moose to step over. They don't even pause, okay? And that's a female cow moose, and she had babies with it. That bicycle is going to turn around and go the other way. So we can compete with this. We'll have alligators crossing our trails. You can count on them, okay? The Coeur d'Alene. And in Florida, this is our current longest. This is the Withlacoochee State Trail on the west coast of Florida. I'll show you on a map a little bit later where it is. But it's currently 62 miles, but it's about to become part of this whole network. This will be one of the pieces that will connect with the coast to coast. The hard stuff on this trail has already been done. This bridge has just been finished. It was dropped in place about 18 months ago, and it's already covered up. It's amazing. You just build it, and they are coming. So this is the Withlacoochee in North Florida, rather in West Florida. Okay. So I'm still going to show you some examples of what these regionally connected trails look like all across North America. How is this possible? How can we go to a national system of connected trails in such a short period of time? That's the transition we have gone through in less than 100 years. Okay. We have gone from a railroad system to a transportation system based on the automobiles. And these are the fragments that have been acquired piece by piece all over the United States, and these are all now trails. Everything you see here is now a trail. This is the John Wayne Pioneer Trail in Washington, 253 miles long. This is the High Trestle. You'll see this one again in Iowa. The Père Marquette Trail in the Lower Peninsula of Michigan. And by the way, that's an interesting structure. They call that the Tridge. It's a tri-bridge. So rather than do a bridge across there and then another bridge across there, they went out to a center post and built that. That's a tourist attraction. Midland, Michigan. You got to look it up and go see it. Tridge. The Virginia Creeper, the highest trail in the east, up above Damascus, Virginia. The Cardinal Greenway in Indiana. The Candy Mountain Express Bikeway in Utah and Sacramento, Virginia. All over the United States. Railroads are being abandoned, and if we're lucky, we're doing this to them. Okay, this was the first one. This is the famous Elroy to Sparta in Wisconsin. And this was like 1965. And along with acquiring the corridor, we acquired these amazing structures, okay? These are tunnels through mountains. bridges from the 19th century, some beautiful ironworks. This is the legacy from the 19th century to us, and we're starting to save them. The next one along line was the Illinois Prairie Path in Illinois, just outside of Chicago. And then connecting to these other corridors that were being converted, these old canal corridors, all of a sudden, all across America, these things become possible because of what came before them. Now, that's what the United States looked like at the turn of the 20th century. Look at that map. You could go from Seattle to Key West, all by rail. It was all there. That was the longest connected rail system in the world, in the United States. Ever since then, ever since the Great Depression, when a lot of the railroads first began to fail, and then accelerating after World War II as we built the interstate highway system, this great system of connected railroads have become completely unraveled and have been reconnected as mainline corridors. So this vast connectivity that you see here, that you could go from Los Angeles to Chicago, to Boston, to Maine, all that is just now a thing of the past. So we are doing this in the 21st century because people woke up to this and they said, hey, we may need these railroad corridors again. You know, I mean, the railroads haven't gone away. They've just changed their function dramatically, mostly to hauling freight. But someday we may need them again. And one thing we've learned over and over and over again, it's far easier to keep these corridors intact and figure out a way to use them than it is to reassemble them. And I'll show you an example a little bit later in this presentation. But if we keep these corridors intact, they have 1,000 uses. They can be used for gas pipelines, sewer line rights of way, water line rights of way, alternate transportation system, fiber optic lines, and of course, my favorite, recreational trails. Okay? So this is good public policy at its core. And I try to emphasize this when I talk to legislators, that they're not just building recreational trails, they're saving some of the most important property that we have still in the United States, these old railroad corridors, and keeping them intact for the future. Okay, now going to Florida from here. This is an old map of the Florida East Coast Railway at the turn of the century, and you can see all these rail corridors that were coming all the way across. These aren't highways, these are railroad corridors. You could go from Pensacola to Jacksonville, to Gainesville, to Cedar Key, to Orlando, to Miami, Key West. This railroad came all the way down to Miami, into the Florida Keys, and then I'll show you another slide in a bit. They would load the trains onto specially designed barges and take them across to Havana, fill them with fruit, and be back to New York City in 24 hours. 1910, this is all being done. And it started with these two guys. Most people don't realize that modern Florida was built around this railroad network. Henry Flagler and Henry Plant. Henry Flagler on the east coast of the United States, and Henry Plant on the west coast began to convert, which was a chaotic system of different gauge railroads, into a seamless system where you could travel through it. And they did it for their own convenience. Henry Flagler was part of the Rockefeller family fortune. He was the corporate attorney that developed the modern corporate form of ownership. And he was extremely wealthy. He took his fortune, and so he and his wife would come from New York in the winter to St. Augustine. He had to change trains like 12 times. He hated that, so he bought up all the railroads and standardized the gauge. I mean, that's what you can do with money, isn't it? So they could get to St. Augustine without getting off a train. Well, their friends figured that out and came down to visit. And he gradually began extending it. If you are interested in this piece of Florida history, you need to read this book, Last Train to Paradise, by Les Stanford. It's an incredible story of the building of modern Florida around this railroad. This railroad got to Key West in 1912. They built it across the Florida Keys, and they called it the railroad that went to sea. It was the eighth wonder of the engineering world at the beginning of the 20th century. This is what started it all in Florida. This was the first ever contracted and second built railroad that linked Tallahassee to the St. Louis, to the coast. This was a 16.5 mile conversion back in 1985 that really created the first model for what to do with this. And the Department of Transportation bought this corridor to to rail bank it and then let the recreational community have it. Now, I mentioned earlier about the economics of this. The way we sold this project to the Department of Transportation in 1985 was, gosh, what would it cost to acquire a 60-foot right-of-way between Tallahassee and the coast if they ever needed a port connection or a pipeline connection? With a little bit of work in their long-range planning section, they came back and said a 60-foot corridor, 20 miles long, about $5.5 million. They bought it for $150,000. The economics of this thing are ridiculous. I mean, these corridors, by their very nature, are far easier to buy than they are to reassemble. So this was converted to trail first ever. But then, very soon, communities all over Florida began to see the magic of this, and these began to pop. The Pinellas Trail in Pinellas County, the Whippacoosa State Trail, which we mentioned. Here's the famous West Orange. The commissioners in Orange County went to visit this trail, couldn't wait to come back to appropriate money to do this one, and you all probably enjoyed this one. And then the Seminole-Wakiva. All of these trails were followed shortly thereafter. Then, the Overseas Heritage Trail in the Keys. This is part of the old cross-border barge canal. That trail exists. You go out to look at the bay. The Amelia Island Trail, which winds through the hammocks on Amelia Island. The Legacy Trail in Sarasota, which was the old right-of-way for the Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey Circus, when they brought all their animals from Baraboo, New York, to Florida in the winter because elephants and giraffes don't like New York winters. They came here to Sarasota, and that's the corridor that brought all those animals here. There are people who still remember the elephants getting off the trains and walking through downtown. Okay, it was just yesterday that all this was there. So these trails exist, and then some of the other ones that are working on Big Talbot Island through a state park in North Florida, beautiful trails, and then this one, which is the East Coast Greenway, which is the visionary trail that's being developed all the way from the Canadian border, Calais, Maine, through the 12 major cities on the East Coast, Boston, New York City, Philadelphia, all the way to Florida, and it's going to end up in Key West. It's under development right now. So, all around Florida, as these corridors were abandoned, local and state governments began to acquire the rights away and build these trails. And in this effort, Florida has some unique assets. This is one of the keys. In the 1990s, under the Lloyd Childs administration, Chapter 260 of the Florida statutes were approved, creating the Florida Greenways and Trails Act. This led to the creation of the master plan that I showed you in the earlier slides. And this is the basis for the Sun Trails Network, as I'll get to in just a few minutes. So this was all created in the 1990s to set the stage for this. In addition, in the 1980s, a big transportation and transportation planning was going on at the federal level. And they began to move from a focus 100% on a highway system to a multimodal system. And with the development of the Intermodal Surface Transportation Act, the so-called ICE-T Act, funding became available from the federal government for the first time to start doing things other than building highways. And they began to build trails. And they began to do a lot of other things. So if you don't know about this program, this is a very interesting thing you should look into, because it was the first step in a major transformation that's undergoing still to this day. And this legislation also created the modern transportation planning process that led to the Metropolitan Planning Organizations, the Transportation Planning Organizations, Metro Plan, and everything else. So, Harry, you owe your job to this federal legislation, don't you? This is all part of that transformation. Letting local governments have a bigger say in setting transportation priorities all over the state. But something else was happening in Florida. And most people don't connect these two together, and they need to. Because in 1990, Florida passed the first ever Preservation 2000 program. And then in 2000, they renewed that program and called it the Florida Forever Act. These were the big state of Florida land buying programs. And well over $1.5 billion has been spent by the taxpayers to acquire a great deal of real estate in Florida. Just to give you some statistics here. In 1980, before these programs started, less than 5% of the state of Florida was publicly owned. And most of that was in the big national parks like the Everglades National Parks, the national forests like the Ocala, and the big military bases like Avon Park and Eglin Airfield. That's where most of the public land was. 5% of Florida. 20 years into this program, 26% of Florida is now publicly owned. Just think about that. 20% of the state of Florida has been purchased back for us. to protect these unique landscapes in Florida. So these things began to be acquired. The Gainesville Hawthorne Trail, right here, through Payne's Ferry. The Nature Coast Trail, which comes across the Salina River on that absolutely gorgeous bridge right there, and up in the Panhandle, the Blackwater Heritage Trail. So the 2000, all this land buying was going on simultaneously with all these abandoned railroad corridors, lucky, lucky us. And the total of all these programs and efforts had led to the 600 miles of paved trail segments all over the state of Florida. And I'm going to show you that in a second. When these trails began to come online, an amazing thing began to happen. They turned out to be immensely popular. DOT's biggest complaint was, we can't keep the people off the trails until we finish them. They're out there, okay? The hunger for this is intense. So that began to change people's thinking. And so this is the second point I wanted to remind you about. Not only was the acquiring of these corridors good public policy at its core, but that we don't do enough of this. All over the United States, wonderful things are happening through partnerships with the private sector and government. We seem to not pay any attention to the good things we're doing. We focus on all the things that aren't working. This is working. 20 years of good policy, private initiative, and elected official leadership can produce real results, and I'm about to show you what this is going to look like when it's all put together. Okay, those are the 600 miles all over Florida, and I'm going to highlight a few of them. This is the Withlacoochee State Trail. This is the south, this is the West Orange and the South Lake County Trail. This is the Seminole Ukiah. This is the Suncoast. I'm sorry. No, this is the Van Fleet. This is the Withlacoochee. This is the Suncoast. This is the Pinellas, and on and on and on. You see all the pieces. This is the Tallahassee St. Marks that you see a picture of. There's a piece over here in Walton County. This is where the Amelia Island trails are up in here. This is the Gainesville Hawthorne piece. This is the Florida Keys Heritage Trail. This is a piece of South Dade County along the former FEC Railroad, by the way. That's what the system looks like. Not much of a system, is it? Okay? But watch, I'm sure there's some things that are going to start happening. That's what it looks like. And this is where we came into the picture. The foundation decided in 2010, as a not-for-profit organization, that there were enough of these local trails on the ground that there was widespread recognition of the popularity. It was time to go public with all this stuff. So we created the program here referred to, the Close the Gaps campaign. We launched it on behalf of the Office of Greenways and Trails. And we did this because we're a not-for-profit organization. Mission is very simple. Advocate for and help create a statewide system to connect the trails and greenways. This meets our mission. And we're also a citizen support organization, which is allowed by the Florida statute. It gives us direct access to the public record information that the state agencies have. So everything I'm sharing with you tonight is public information. It's not something we've come up with. It's all there. We're just presenting it in a package that makes it easy for people to get. Okay? So let's go look at a case of this at work. This is what Central Florida looks like right now. This is West Orange, South Lake, Van Fleet, Withlacoochee, Good Neighbor Trail, Suncoast. That, look at the legend. This is existing paved trails in Central Florida. That doesn't look like much. And then we had the thought, thanks to some coaching from the DOT, is like, well, you're not looking at the right data set on this. If you look what's in the work plan, and that's what this blue is, these are programmed and funded trails that were in the work plan of the Department of Transportation and the MPOs, so we added that to the map. And if you add the color blue, the green, it looked like something. Okay, look at this over here. This is the East Central Regional Rail Trail that connects Titusville all the way back across. That piece was in the work plan to be built. That piece was in the work plan. That piece was in the work plan. That piece was. Well, that looks interesting. So we added, okay, where do we need more? How can we fill in these gaps? Is there land already in public possession that we could use to fill the gaps? And so we added another color, the blue dotted lines. And then you see this. We actually had land there. We actually had land up here. This is over on the Space Coast. That's all public land out of the Cape. So with a little bit now of imagining, we came up with this. Okay, those are the true gaps. If we connect the seven gaps with the 14 existing trails, that's the project. And that's what launched this whole thing. That's the coast-to-coast connect. All the way from the Atlantic Ocean, the Canaveral National Seashore, all the way across Florida to downtown St. Petersburg, this pops out right next to the Dolly Museum, if any of you have been there. Okay, very, very cool place. That's not all, as they say on the campaign commercial, there's more. On top of this one, once this is underway, if you add the other green trails that exist, you see something here. This is the extension of the Whistler up to Denellen, and there's these pieces over here. Okay, well, let's add the blue. Oh, looky here. They're about to build a paved trail across the Cross Florida Greenway from Silver River State Park almost all the way back to Denellen. Okay, let's add the other land in public ownership. Okay, all of a sudden, this is connected. This is almost all done. This fills in, and this becomes possible. We're now talking in active negotiations to connect all the way across the Ocala National Forest, and the next major project is right in the wings. This is what we're calling the Heart of Florida Loop. Look at the combination of what these two are going to do to the ability to get around Central Florida. Okay, look at the possible combinations. And then, all of a sudden, you started looking at other public lands that exist in this whole quarter, and that becomes very possible. About a third of that, if there are already trails, you can see the green, that all we need to do is connect them together. So Central Florida is very rich right now in possibilities for trail connection. And then thanks to all of this discussion that's been going on, all of a sudden I get a call from a friend of mine in Osceola County, that they're working on this. Okay? Here, you've seen this, haven't you? This is where we are right now. This is the UCF main campus out here. These are the trails that actually exist in the Central Florida area. Doesn't look like much. Remember, we're looking at existing. If you add the program, we're starting to get a lot of new pieces beginning to come together. If you then add the prioritized, that's the coast to coast, point of reference, that's the one we're trying to connect into. If you add the program funds, and then the priority funds, and then what's being thought of and planned, that is another major loop that becomes possible in Central Florida. Connect down through the Shingle Creek in the city of Kissimmee, connect to that wonderful bike trail that's along here to the south side of St. Cloud, and up to the Coosie Road, and then that's, of course, all over Lake Nona and all the big development talk that's been in the paper would be taking place. But look at the possibilities in Central Florida. Okay. So this is all coming together. Land acquisition, abandoned railroad corridors, all this kind of stuff. But there are other factors contributing to all of this, and I'm going to run through them. This was a real turning point. In 2014, a publication came out called Dangerous by Design. And unfortunately, Florida was number one. We are the number one most dangerous state for bicycles and pedestrians in America. What a terrible statistic. And it got the attention of the Florida Department of Transportation. I think the secretary, Facade at the time, then was quoted as saying, this is not a category, we want to be number one. We want to put this behind us. So, and you've all seen these areas. You've seen pedestrian people in wheelchairs trying to maneuver up side streets, drainage ditches on the sides of roads, kids trying to get across busy highways. That's what a lot of our state still looks like, and it's a terrible situation. With the conversion of these trails, you begin to get the economic impacts. This is now what Winter Garden looks like. And these are what our streets are beginning to start looking like, okay? So the conversion of these corridors has created and restored a vital economic benefit to these mid-sized communities, and the trails are now credited with playing a major role in a lot of these transformations that are going on. This is one of my favorites, because trails are incredibly inclusive. There is nobody who's excluded from these trails, and they include the walkers, the bicyclists, children, wheelchairs, rollerbladers, the elderly, dogs. They're all welcome. Come on out. Enjoy yourself in the outdoors on our trails. But there's another fact, and this came about through a lot of studies. You all know about this. Active Transportation America, as a nation, we're becoming increasingly concerned about the overweight tens, the sedentary lifestyles that our people have. Obesity is becoming a terrible problem, and public health officials are looking at ways to solve this. This was part of this findings in the Active Transportation America. Half of the trips in the United States can be completed with a 20-minute bike ride. Half. And a quarter of these trips within a 20-minute walk. Yet the vast majority of these short trips are taken by automobile. Why? Why is this happening? Well, I told someone earlier over hors d'oeuvres, 9 out of 10 households in Florida have bicycles. How many use them? 1 out of 10. The perception is it's not worth taking your bike to the grocery store because you could die in the process. Just too dangerous out there. So the perception, the reality of danger is keeping people from doing what they would do if we can fix all this. So we can fix this. This is one example of how we're fixing it. This is, go look this one up, Greenville, South Carolina, Swamp Rabbit Trail. Great name for a trail, right? That was the name of the railroad because it hopped through the swamps of South Carolina. This came about because the Greenville Health System in 2007 said we need to do something dramatic to fix this problem. And so they saw this rare opportunity to promote both general welfare and to specifically address a unique acute illnesses such as cardiovascular disease in one project. They pledged $100,000 a year for 10 years and they helped the community build this network. You can now go from Greenville, South Carolina, all the way down to Traveler's Rest. If you haven't taken it, go ride it. It's an absolutely gorgeous two-day trip. It's beautiful. Swamp Rabbit. And AARP is in on this one too. They know this is important for the elderly. Thanks to modern medicine and decades of economic process progress, we're all living longer. And we have to find ways to encourage more activity as we age if we're going to keep our citizens a vibrant part of our communities. The last thing is the tourism. Florida right now is the number one tourist destination in the world. You may not know this, but last year we had something like 96 million visitors. At any time of the year, we have upwards of 800,000 people in Florida from other parts of the world. So, wow, we can capture that on top of everything else. Look at these trails that we're beginning to create everywhere around the United States. And then, this is one that's just come recently. This is kind of interesting. It appears that a whole of the current generation of Americans are beginning to look for mobility alternatives. They're increasingly eager to abandon their cars in favor of something else. Florida Trend magazine recently did an editorial. Mark Howard wrote this. My daughter, a 23-year-old professional in St. Petersburg, rode her bike to work last week, a commute of less than 2 miles. Unremarkable as that may seem, her choice of transport reflects powerful generational trends that are shaping Florida communities. Don't underestimate this one. This could really be a major factor in getting us where we're going. And then the last one, these trails have become amenities more important to development than even golf courses all over the United States. It's the number one request of amenity in most developments these days, give us trails. Okay, Florida Transportation System. We're very lucky. We have enlightened leadership from Florida Department of Transportation. We have one of the district secretaries here with us tonight. We can talk more about that. They've been part of this from the very beginning. They acquired the St. Mark Trail. They're a real big part of this. Recently, in 2014, the Complete Streets Program, a major step forward for the state of Florida. They supported this from the very beginning. They were backing the Connector Program and the Sun Trails Program. They said, this would be good for Florida. We support it. And then that's where the $25 million came from. Big thanks to Senate President Andy Garner for helping us do this. He led this impact from the very beginning. We are now poised to be the first state in America construct a statewide system of connected trails. Last to first. Isn't that a great way to go? Okay, so what's this going to look like? We're almost finished. This is what Florida is going to look like if we connect all the current trails that are on the master plan of the Office of Greenways and Trails under the Sun Trails program. That's the coast to coast. That's the heart of Florida. That's what we're calling the Northeast Coast Connector from Fernandina Beach down to the coast to coast. That's the Southwest Coast. That'll link Tampa Bay all the way to Naples. That is that almost entire corridor would connect Dunellen at the corner of the heart of Florida to Taliesin. 70 of those miles are owned by a single power company on a abandoned railroad right away. That could be done in one transaction. Gainesville to Hawthorne is part of that old Florida connector. Connect all the way from Pensacola back to Tallahassee, St. Mark's, and down to the Nature Coast Regional Connector. River Grass Greenways, all the way from Naples back across the Miami, across the Big Cypress in the Everglades. 100% public ownership of the right way. We got some issues, but we own all the land. This piece coming up, the East Coast Greenway, we talked about it before, South Miami all the way up to Titusville. And then the Florida Keys pieces drop in. And this is what the state of Florida could look like in 20 years. All this stuff could be connected. Okay, the white lines are just all the outline pieces that weren't part of the meeting. So you've heard from me, now I want to hear from the locals. couple of short videos here.
Anything that we can do to get people to exercise. Get them healthier is good for our community, reduces our overall costs from a healthcare standpoint. Bicycling is great exercising. But the other thing, I don't want to focus just on bicycling because I see people walking on the trails. I see people that are skateboarding on the trails, that are rollerblading on the trails. So there's so many different things you can do from an exercise standpoint. Utilizing the trails, that's good for the community. It's good for people in general to get healthier. So it's a great thing. Having a coast-to-coast connector like this really sets Florida apart from a lot of other states. It really makes us unique. It enhances us from a tourism standpoint. It enhances us from an economic development standpoint. And going back to our last question, it enhances us from a health standpoint. We're going to be a healthier community. We're going to be a more attractive community for tourists. And certainly, economically, I think we'll be a more viable community. Having that connection that will take place going coast-to-coast.
Mayor Peter.
The first year I ran for mayor, which is 2008, there's actually another trail that is in the works. It's called the St. Johns River to the Sea Loop Trail. And I rode the inaugural ride of that trail and just became really fascinated in bicycle trails at that point. In fact, that's probably when I first met Dale Allen. And so doing a little research, I recognized the incredible economic potential of these trails. And what's neat about the trails coming to Titusville is the St. Johns River to the Sea Loop Trail and the Coast-to-Coast Connector follow the exact same real estate between Titusville and up somewhere near DeBary. So it's really cool for Titusville in that we're probably the only city on both, one of the few cities on both trails. And so, and the fact that we're at the eastern end of the Coast-to-Coast Connector is just huge for us, because we're at the starting point or the ending point, depending on which way you go. But when you combine the two trails, it's even more spectacular, because you'll be able to ride from Titusville to DeBary and then make a choice. You can either take a right turn and head north on the Loop Trail, or you can make a left turn and head west to St. Petersburg and ride across the state. So I expect there'll be a lot of people who will ride one or the other of those trails and then come back again following year or sometime later to ride the other trail that they didn't get to do on the first try. So for us, it's just huge.
In Titusville, we have
Okay, this is the last piece. Who recognizes this? How many of you are registered voters in the state of Florida? How many of you voted in last November's election? How many of you voted for Constitutional Amendment 1? Okay, that's what you voted for. Okay, and look what it's got. It's got a major provision here for spending that money for recreational trails and public access to these conservation lands. That's all going on. All right, now, I'm wrapping up with some images here. This will take just 2 minutes, okay? These are not just our rural trails. This is one of the Cadillacs of them all. This is in downtown Manhattan. This is on the lower west side. It's called the High Line Trail. There's an elevated railroad converted into a trail. This is like $50 million a mile to do this kind of stuff. But it's the number two tourist attraction in the city of New York right now, instead of Liberty. This is a repurposed railroad bridge over the Hudson called the Walkway Over the Hudson, a mile and a quarter. This was opening day. Look at this phenomenon, okay? This is absolutely beautiful. Poughkeepsie's become a tourist attraction. This is the High Trestle. This one is beautiful in the day, but it's even more beautiful at night because they've illuminated this thing and they try to create effect of going through a tunnel as you're traversing the bridge. Absolutely stunning. People come out and use this all kinds of day. We built this in Florida already. This is if you go across the Courtney Campbell Causeway from Tampa to St. Pete, look off to your left. That's the new first ever bicycle pedestrian bridge totally dedicated to the state of Florida. This whole thing is a separate facility for bicyclists and pedestrians. This is the Florida Keys Heritage Trail. It's being converted as we speak. 80% of it's done. And this is what's going on around the world. To wrap this up, this is Canada. Look what they're doing. Especially like this piece over here. The illuminated bridges. Trans-Canadian Trail over here. The Netherlands. This is stunning. They're embedding paint chips, luminescent paint chips in their asphalt, soak up a light during the day and illuminate at night, so you have a colored pathway that you can ride on 24 hours. Look at this. This is called a floating roundabout. This is the first ever roundabout above travel in the Netherlands. Germany, along all the rivers, Germany's well connected. Copenhagen. Look at this one. This is what they call the cycle snake. Sickenlange. And this one, the spike leading through this colorized plaza. South Korea, our Asian friends, are also hard at work. South Korea is rapidly becoming the most bicycle-connected nation on Earth because of this. Look what they're doing. Look at these beautiful trails, the Four Rivers bike path in Seoul, Busan. Japan, the Shimonami Kaido Bikeway. Look at this, look what's going on here. This is a bikeway. Look at this, the bamboo path. Taiwan, rail trails, Sun Moon Lake bike path. There, this is advertised in there. You'd think you were somewhere in Germany. This is Taiwan, and then the Rainbow Bridge. So here are the conclusions. These trails are good public policy. They have a broad base of public support, especially in these economic times. They have a broad base of public benefits. You've seen them all. And it preserves a railroad legacy for Florida's future. Thank you all very much for listening to me. Gary, while the things said, I would just like to scroll through some of the groups that have helped us in this whole process. As you see, it takes a team to build a trail.
Okay, we're going to do a quick transition into the panelist part of the program. And this is where we have a tradition at the speaker series here, where we invite some subject matter experts to take part in a discussion, kind of a catalyst for some other thinking. And tonight I'm very proud that we've got three terrific panelists joining us. The first panelist is Billy Hathaway. Billy, if you can join us up here, take a comfortable seat. Billy's here in a dual role tonight. Many of you know him. If you don't know him personally, you know him by reputation. But Billy's here tonight first in his role as the chairman, the volunteer board chairman of Bike Walk Central Florida. This is a nonprofit organization dedicated to promoting safe pedestrian and bicycle use here in Central Florida, with a very important task of doing an outstanding job. And in addition, Billy is also the District 1 Secretary for the Florida Department of Transportation. This position is actually based in Bartow, Florida. It takes in a 12-county area to the south of Polk County, and then over to the west, the Fort Myer area. And I got to tell you, as most of you know who are in the transportation business, this is a big job that Billy's got with an enormous amount of responsibility. And nevertheless, he still finds a tremendous amount of time for a variety of special projects and for an extraordinary amount of volunteer work. So I've told him when he's ready to retire, eventually I want him doing time management courses, and I'll be the first to sign up. But he really does an extraordinary job. So thanks for joining us tonight, Billy. Our next panelist is Fabricio Ponce. Fabricio, if you can take a seat. Fabricio is the Transportation System Manager at VHB. VHB has 23 offices along the East Coast of the United States, and Fabricio is based here in the Orlando office. Fabricio is currently working on several projects that are going to be part of the Coast to Coast Trail. So he brings some very important perspective to tonight's conversation. Fabricio has his undergraduate degree from the Universidad Nacional de Cordoba in Argentina, and his graduate degree from the University of Florida. I neglected to mention that Billy earned his undergraduate degree in civil engineering at Wentworth Institute of Technology and his MBA from Florida State University. If I did the data thing, I did the seminal thing, I hear about it afterwards in my proceedings. So, having the balance there. And we have a tradition at this series of always inviting a student as well who's a part of the master's program in urban regional planning to be part of the panel. And tonight, I'm very happy to let you know that Kelly Carson is going to be joining us as a panelist, and as Kelly works her way down here. Kelly's in the program on a part-time basis right now, but she is working full-time as a planner for the city of Winter Garden. And you heard Dale mention the extraordinary transformation that's happened in the city of Winter Garden over the years, and it is really remarkable. I've lived in Central Florida now, come up on 20 years, and you see what happened there. It's really extraordinary. And the West Orange Trail has been an important part of the evolution of what's taking place in that community. Before joining the City of Winter Garden, Kelly worked in the landscape architecture field in Washington State, where she was involved in the design of public parks and recreation facilities, including several regional trails. Kelly earned her undergraduate degree in landscape architecture from the University of Washington in Seattle. So I'd like to thank our panelists for being part of tonight's conversation. And I'm going to begin with a question that I'd like each of our panelists to answer. Dale covered a tremendous amount of information tonight. Almost in the allotted time. I knew he'd get time to answer the problem. You go over with all the great pictures and all the enthusiasm. How do you cut him off? You know? But he had a tremendous amount of information.
Yeah, I guess I want to start off by saying this amazing presentation. It was really great and really inspiring to you know, hear what your organization is doing, Dale, and also to see, you know, what's being done across the country and across the world. I think that more so than anything, I was really, really inspired by seeing all those projects. And I think, you know, being a planner, and I was just talking about this with Roberta over in the lobby, you know, we get so bogged down, or at least I know I do, with just seeing, you know, looking at maps and seeing a master plan and just seeing how to connect point A to point B, but then you realize that trails have such potential to you know, provide these really unique, transformative experiences. Like you saw that one in, what was it, Copenhagen or the Netherlands? The cycle snake or the integrated, the paint ships that glow in the nighttime. I mean, that's something you ride on and you'll never forget. So I think that's really inspiring to see that, you know, not only think about how to connect point A to point B, but what does it feel like to ride on these trails? And yeah, I think that more than anything is really inspiring as a practitioner, as a student.
Fabrizio, what about you? Anything new in Dale's presentation, or anything that caused you to think about things differently?
Well, you know, we're kind of aware of what's going on in Florida and the different trade plans and programs and projects, but to see all together in one slide, I mean, it's really impressive. And I think it tells us, number one, how far we've come. But the other thing is what a great future we have ahead of us and how we're gonna go through a tremendous transformation. So that's really exciting and definitely inspiring. But also it tells us that, hey, we can be like those places, those great places in the world, you know? Yeah, exactly. So we can become a world trail destination. So that's really exciting.
The highway system did not happen overnight. No. It evolved over time, and that's what we're seeing emerge with this. Yeah. Billy, how about you? Something new, different, surprising?
I've seen Dale's presentation before, and he's been lobbying me for a while, so I didn't see a whole lot of this stuff. But both through Bike Walk Central Florida and my role at Florida UT, but the thing that I think today's presentation was helpful to remind me of is the importance of these historic railroad corridors. Keep in mind, these historic railroad corridors were the basis for our historic downtowns, like Winter Park and Orlando, where we had densely gridded networks of streets, and so consequently they were very walkable, in contrast to most of what we built after World War II, where the interstate system became so prevalent. So the fact that we can use these trails as ways to help revitalize these historic downtowns like Winter Garden has been extremely successful, and I've seen the restoration since I came back to the Orlando area in 2006. It was just a good reminder that preserving these corridors is really important for the long-term vitality of these historic downtowns.
Billy, why don't you hold on to that? Many of the students who are member of the room, and some of us who have been out of school for a while, urban planning kind of has its roots in public health. Remember way back when there were all these problems with urbanizing populations and public health issues, and maybe there's a better way to go about doing this. It's interesting that we see things now evolving again, putting a lot more emphasis on public health. Billy, I was curious from your perspective, both Bike Walk Central Florida and Florida DOT, how do you see the evolution of the greenways and trail system throughout the state being helpful as far as public health is concerned? A lot more than you put on that pipe.
Well, I see them having a very important role. I'm an avid cyclist. I'm one of those spandex riders that you see every Saturday out riding on our 4 and 6 lane highways. And most of our population is not comfortable riding in that environment. And so the trails provide a great alternative for people to get out and exercise. And as this network expands, there's just going to be more and more opportunities. I think Dale's presentation made the important points about the challenges that we have nationally with obesity and with improving the health of all of the age groups, including the younger generation, which, based on what I've heard, has the potential for having shorter lifespans than even my generation. So that's something I'm very concerned about, and is a big part of why I'm very active in Bike Walk Central Florida, which is funded primarily by the Winter Park Health Foundation, focused on improving health. So I think that there's a huge benefit from that perspective. The other thing is that, again, connecting our historic downtowns, you know, having Winter Park is not that far from downtown Orlando. I ride my bike there all the time. But again, because not everyone's comfortable getting on McGuire, for example, and riding through Baldwin Park to get to Winter Park, having these trails connect these communities together, where once people get to those destinations, they can go to restaurants and walk to retail and that sort of thing. Again, it just improves the health of all of our citizens. And like Dale pointed out so well, the number of short distance trips that are used, where people use nothing but the automobile, is something that we have to help overcome that. And I think that's a tremendous benefit. One of the reasons why I live in downtown Orlando is because when I get home, I don't have to drive anywhere.
Fabrizio, up to this point, we've been talking about the concept of a statewide network of trails. You're on the front line helping to design some segments of the coast to coast. Doing a trail is a lot more than putting down some blacktop and keeping your fingers crossed that people are going to come out and enjoy the experience. What are some of the challenges that you face in actually designing segments of the trail that you think the students and faculty members and practitioners who are here with us tonight need to understand?
Well, first let me say, in working before we got to the design, during the planning phase, something that was, at least for us, really, really surprising, I guess, is that we were trying to identify, we had two different alternatives, and we were trying to identify which one was basically the most appropriate one. And we ended up having two communities fighting for the trail.
Is this the one involving Webster?
Yes.
Yes. You might want to explain to folks about the rivalry that's going on in the trail.
And honestly, we were not expecting that. So that was really, really exciting. We were expecting quite the opposite. But one is basically, this is the Sumter Gap. So we have the city of Webster on the north. And it was very interesting because we had the first public meeting, and the first public meeting was on the north side. So we had all the people from the Webster residents and living in that area, basically speaking on support of the trail. And well, we thought, well, it's pretty clear that looks like we have a winner. It's the north one. And immediately after that, the Pasco County NPO, they said, no, you need to come to Pasco. We really want the trail. And that's exactly what's happening now. The Pasco community, they said, no, we want the trail. And this was probably 3 weeks ago. We went to one of the NPO board meetings. And of course, we had the NPO speaking, all the NPO board members speaking in support of the trail. And all of a sudden, the mayor of Webster was basically there saying, no, I just want to tell you that I want the trail. So that was definitely interesting. Another thing is, and when looking at the coast to coast, we see that, okay, it's 250 miles, and we think, okay, we are 200 miles, are already there, we only have 50 miles, so we're 80% there. It's like, yeah, we are, but you know what? If there's a gap, there's a reason for that. So the easy stuff is done. Yes. So the gaps are definitely the most challenging parts of the trail. And of course, depending if you're in a rural area or if you're in an urban area, you're facing different set of challenges. We're working on the Orange Gap, and of course, everything you touch is expensive. It's almost like pick your poison. It's either right of way or impacting utilities. So that's So those are decisions that need to be made.
Kelly, we hear a lot, Dale included in his presentation, about the economic developments, economic benefits associated with trails and related development. In your opinion, from Winter Garden and your experience maybe in Washington State, is this wishful thinking or is this just going to automatically happen?
Well, I do work for Winter Garden, and as Dale has presented tonight, I mean, the city of Winter Garden is a living, breathing testament to the power of trails to really revitalize a community. I mean, that's exactly what happened. If you visited Winter Garden in circa 1990, it was a mess. It was an absolute mess. It was, I think there were two restaurants were open downtown. There was some scattered retail operations that were pretty much failing. The housing prices were not great. It was just a mess, and it was really the foresight of activists in the community as well as the city to run the trail downtown in an effort to bring more people downtown, to kind of use that as an economic driver in a really big way. And now we have basically no available retail space. We have a very thriving restaurant community. We have a waiting list of people who want to open up a business downtown, but there's literally no room. It's grown faster than we can keep up with in terms of, you know, supply of retail space and office space. So it's really an amazing testament. I mean, it's just been great because we have, I think at last count it was about 75,000 riders come through Winter Garden on a monthly basis, and those are people who visit Winter Garden's restaurants. Those are people who shop at local shops in Winter Garden. Those are people who, and even if they don't patronize the businesses then, it's just a great marketing tool. Maybe they'll come back at a later date. So it's living proof that is certainly a very tangible way to revitalize communities using power trails.
Plus, you know, there's an emerging suburb of Winter Garden, the booming community of Oakland. There's a lot happening there. There's a whole community fund up promoting the West Orange Trail. So this is a whole community that's been kind of playing around.
Dale, sure. Can I comment on that? Because I think this is where it goes back to a lot of the student planners in the audience. We are not looking at the completed project in Winter Garden, the successful trail. But if you were around when this whole thing was developing, it didn't happen exactly like it seems. The reason the opportunity was there in the first place is there was a railroad that went right through the downtown lengthwise. And every two or three times a week, that train would have to back through the downtown and just gridlock everything. And when we first proposed the trail, the railroad, we said, gee, we'd really be nice if you'd go away and we could take over. And they said, no, we're not going to leave. So the first alignment was along the sidewalks. Okay, did anyone remember when the trail went along the sidewalk and there were multiple collisions between people coming out of stores and restaurants and getting hit by bicyclists? And the merchant said, oh no, this is not a good idea. This is not going to work. So they then went back and looked at who owned the right-of-way under the railroad, and it turned out the city owned all the right-of-way, but the railroad had adverse possession because they were there. So they said, okay, we can't make you leave. We'll put a fence up, and we'll put the trail right next to you. And so that's when the trail came downtown. And then 3 years of this, with the trail riders riding alongside the railroad said, okay, all right, we're out of here. So, for Francisco's point, you know, you got to work your way through all the adversary of this stuff, because change doesn't happen overnight, and it doesn't come in one swoop. It comes incrementally, piece by piece, and you just got to grab the opportunity one step at a time.
I got another question for Kelly. You know, Dale showed us a lot of exciting examples from his travels around the country and around the world, and he suggested these are big draws for tourism. That example you showed from Canada is interesting, right? Another whole month for their tourism season. Picture the completion of the coast-to-coast trail. Do you think this is going to be successful in drawing visitors from around the country and around the world to us here in Central Florida?
I do, and like Dale pointed out, I think we already have a leg up in that arena, being, you know, the number one tourist destination in the world.
550,000 people here on an average day visiting us.
Exactly. So I think we already have an incredible head start in that arena. And I think it's just a matter of you know, advertising our trails to draw people who might not, you know, you have people come for Disney, they come for the theme parks, they come for various things. I think that there's probably a burgeoning market maybe in ecotourism or people who want to come and experience, you know, the wealth of natural beauty that we have here in Florida. So yeah, I think there's a huge opportunity, and I can definitely see this becoming an international tourist destination.
Well, for that to happen, I got a question for Fabrizio along those lines. We have a world-class trail system. I did think you need to have a package of amenities in addition to pavement. What amenities are being included today in the planning work of the Coast to Coast Trail? And what more needs to be done to help ensure its success with respect to amenities?
That's a very interesting question. you know that this first step is basically to close the gaps. And that's really the main focus. The idea is, let's close the gap, and then the amenities is basically the next step. And that's really the real challenge. How are you going to pay for those amenities? And then how are you going to maintain those amenities? And that's something that we really need to figure out. And I think not only DOT, but local governments need to really start thinking about, okay, we're going to get all these benefits from the trail. How can we implement those amenities? But of course, we need to start with the easy stuff or the basics, like, okay, you need benches and picnic pavilions and parking lots. But also then, if you really want a world-class trail, you need to start thinking about, okay, what's the next step? And it's like, okay, you know, bike repair stations and bike washing stations. And of course, mile markers, and all those things that are definitely going to put us in line with the best trails in the world. But again, the challenge is, okay, how do we pay and how do we maintain it?
And in terms of how that's evolving, many of us are accustomed to trail segments today that are in urbanized areas already. So you've got amenities nearby, you've got emergency services nearby. Some of the stretches on these trails that Dale's talking about go for a very, very long distance with absolutely nothing anywhere near. So there's that whole issue about public safety. Okay, got a question for Billy. We're always looking for new and innovative ways to do things in the transportation world, and you've had your share of those adventures. With a lot more emphasis these days being put on communities and private sector involvement, do you see any opportunities for trails generating revenue themselves
to
use to build, operate, or maintain the trail system?
Well, it's a challenge. One of the things that we're looking at, and this is kind of an offshoot of this our statewide initiative to improve bike and ped safety, was that we have for the first time in this agency's career, or history, I should say, our first bike and ped element of our long-range transportation plan. And my vision for having put that into the system was that out of that would come our first ever bike and ped statewide plan, which would then lead to regional plans for all the districts. And so I'm hoping part of what that will help is with these issues of setting priorities, and of course working with Dale and his membership to help establishing priorities for where funding can go throughout the state. We know that there's funding set aside for the trails of $25 million a year, but there's no reason why, working through the NPOs, that we can't look to advance additional segments of the trails. And contrary to my recollection of when trails were first starting to be built, including the St. Mark's Trail in Tallahassee when I lived there, where everybody was worried about this trail being behind their neighborhood and people riding off with flat screen TVs on their bicycles, now you see people advertising that the homes are on the trails, just like we have here in Baldwin Park. So things have moved very much in a different direction, and it's going to take, I think, like a lot of things related to transportation funding in this day and age, with what's not happening in Washington, that we're going to have to work more collaboratively at the state and local level to make many of these projects happen.
Great. Dale, with all the experience you've got traveling around looking at all these different trails, have you ever come across toll for a trail? Do I hear supporters in the audience with those grunts?
The commuters are...
Pass transponder.
Don't laugh. This is an issue. How to maintain these trails, how to make sure they're safe, is an ongoing issue that we have not solved. A number of communities are funding their trail work by charging parking fees at trailheads. That's what Hillsborough County and a number of other counties do. It's fairly painless, $2 a clip, okay, but it doesn't generate a lot of money. Years ago, there was an effort made to pass a recreational one penny tax on recreational sales, bikes and all that kind of stuff. But the retail industry thought this was unfair. They were being singled out for a single purpose tax, so that didn't work. I think what we all agree is that trails really need to continue to be free if they're going to be equitable. And one of the things that really appeals to me is that everybody's welcome. So some states actually require passes. Wisconsin does. You can buy a day pass for $5, you can buy an annual pass for $20. Guess what they sell the most of? Most people buy the annual pass for $20. It's a good deal, okay? But no, we haven't solved this one. We're hoping that Amendment 1 that I showed might provide some support there, because those monies can't be used for management. But at some point, some very smart person is going to have to figure out a way to put an e-pass so that it's like a penny a mile, you know, something very marginal that you don't even feel. And then we have
that. Pay through taxes or pay through user fees.
That's right. There's no other ways.
We all have to pay.
Special taxing districts, who knows what the answer is.
I want to be respectful of the time, but I want to take at least a couple of minutes to give people in the audience an opportunity for a question or two or three. Yes, sir. John. John, correct?
Yeah.
John.
I want to ask, around the world are places where it's a pretty well-established network, and tourists actually are using it in St. George's Island or something. What is the distance or for like accommodations, for overnight accommodations along the way on some of those trails and restaurants and things like that? Is there a particular radius or distance that you need to have something?
This is a challenge because the wide variety of users make for a wide variety of solutions. I think your average bicyclist would do, a recreational bicyclist with a family, 20 to 30 miles a day is a good ride. There are others who will ride 70 to 100 miles. One of the big things that I get a lot of calls is from event planners who want to do fundraisers around various charitable causes, who want to select, you know, do marathons around this stuff. The hotel industry is really going to have to start thinking this through. I would like to see, you know, overnight facilities be kind of in nodes no more than about 25 miles apart. But that would be a good experience for most riders without killing everybody.
And in urban areas, these exist. In some of these other areas, and I'm not talking about the belly of the state, I'm talking about some stretches for coast-to-coast trail, even in Brevard County,
Volusia.
There are huge expanses with absolutely nothing nearby. So, another question? Yes, sir. Can you introduce yourself?
Certainly, I'm Wes, new to the area.
Where did you move from, Wes?
I was living in Tallahassee, but I also lived in Denmark for the last 6 months and experienced trails there. Also, I lived in Minnesota for 6 months this year. Awesome.
Okay. Maybe hard to hear, but the Minnesota and Denmark, and more recently Tallahassee. Wes.
And I will, on that point, though, I will say I at first was somewhat disappointed to find out I would move back to Florida because of all these awesome trails I was experiencing. And of course, I'm quickly, just even in the last week, have been reintroduced to what awesome things are happening here, especially with this presentation, so I've expanded a lot of that in my mind. But not to take it down the notch, I'm curious about when I think of railways, for some reason I equate railways with environmental hazards, such as arsenic that may be in the soil, or things you mentioned the Superfund site.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm curious, are these real environmental challenges people exposed to soils that may have contamination, or is this somewhat not an issue?
Bill, do you
I don't really have
an My general impression of this is it's not an issue. The pavement seals the hazardous materials, it probably becomes dry materials where it gets aerosol and airborne.
So dusty, unpaved trails are far more hazardous than single trail.
They have to be addressed as part of any project. There's hazardous materials of any kind, any transportation project, they have to be addressed.
One more question. Yes, sir. Could you introduce yourself?
I'm Michael Sorrell. I'm in the Masters of Urban Regional Planning Program. I actually had an internship in the city of West Melbourne a while back. They were thinking there was somebody coming in with a development that said, oh, we'd like to do this little trail from this kind of mixed-use area over to these single-family houses. But the officer who was sitting in on the planning discussion was talking about the septic issues, the line of sight issues, crime prevention through environmental design. And he was talking about how if there's nobody seeing that you have all these issues on it, I was wondering how that sort of crime prevention stuff works in these areas, especially when you get out into rural areas. What are the issues?
Good question. Would like to kind of address that. Safety and security.
Yeah, basically.
Trails.
Well, I know how George is doing. George is giving their smart cars to their sheriffs. So they take smart cars and they are on constant patrol. Yeah,
okay.
In smart cars. It's funny, people are funny about this. They see a truck coming down the road and they get really indignant. There's not supposed to be any motor vehicles out here. They see a smart car coming, they go, whoa. That's my friend.
Someone who's lost.
So we got to have appropriate sized vehicles, and there's got to be a law enforcement presence, and then volume is the answer.
This is a big issue. It's put under the umbrella of operating and maintenance responsibilities. Beyond what Dale talked about today, there are a lot of issues with who's responsible for operating and maintaining these things, and safety and security is among those things.
Let me tell you a very short story. I was at the ULI State Conference in Pontevedra in June this year. And one of the presentations was from a big developer in Gloria who's building this 20,000 plus residential community. And yeah, more than 20,000 homes. And they are building this amazing network of trails. And of course they are very concerned about safety and security, and they were approached by a company that basically offered them drones that are going to go over the trail all the time, and they can even have software that if you have an accident or if anything happens to you, the drone would approach you and ask you, are you okay? They decided that, you know, there's a thin line between something that's really technologically advanced and something that's creepy, and they decided this is probably on the creepy side. However, 5 years from now, it may be normal. So they decided they're not going to do it now, but they are going to keep their eyes open.
Let's hear it for our panelists. ACP credits are expected to be available, so stay tuned on how you can receive those. Dr. Feldheim, are the evaluation forms in the room or were they at the desk outside? Do you know? Or Roberta, they're outside?
Yes.
If you could take a moment to complete the evaluation form, that is helpful. Also, anybody who has any suggestions for speakers or topics in the series, those of us who serve on the advisory board would very much like to hear from you. So those of us who are here stood up at the beginning of the event, the students could let faculty members know. And the next lecture is going to be on February 11th. We've got the date set. The venue is going to have to be confirmed. We thought we had a topic. We're still working on that one, but open to suggestions. I think we should have Patricio come and speak on drone technology. This is a good possibility. Okay, I want to thank our speaker. Dale did a wonderful job. Karen, thank you for making the trip also. The panelists need to be thanked, our sponsors, the program's faculty members, and on behalf of the University of Central Florida, I want to thank everyone for coming tonight. Now, as a public service announcement, I know most of you came tonight via Sunrail,
So I want to remind you that the next northbound departure is going to leave the Church Street Station at 9:25, so you've got time for a drink. And the next southbound train is going to be leaving at 8:55. You have time for a quick drink. For those of you who drove tonight, maybe a couple of you, I want you to remember to buckle up and no texting on your way home tonight. So thank you very much for coming again.